Welcome, what's going on? Mr. Lee here. As you can see, this unit is going to be all about farming, and we'll be speedrunning the agriculture unit in about 20 minutes. This is my farm here. We got some animal domestication, market gardening in the middle, and let's not overlook how I nonchalantly have 500k in the bank on the top right-hand corner of your screen.
What are your superpowers again?
I'm rich.
Okay, I'm not that rich, but first, let's throw it back 12,000 years to the Neolithic era, and in reference to the agricultural hearths, you should know the main crops from each hearth. First one being maize and taters from the Central American region. Maize is a form of corn, and you might be asking,
what's taters, precious? What's taters, huh?
Potatoes. Boil them, mash them, stick them in a stew.
Obviously, they're potatoes. Then in Africa, you have your coffee, aka liquid gold. And in case good old College Board tries to throw you a curveball, here's what a coffee plant looks like. We got our wheat and barley in the Fertile Crescent, mango and taro in Southeast Asia. By the way, if you've never had a taro boba drink in your life, go bless yourself. You can tell your parents it was homework. Then lastly, we had rice in the East Asian region. In reference to animal domestication, the New World had llamas and turkeys, whereas the Old World had horses, chicken, and cattle. These forms of agriculture, however, would not be isolated for very long, as good old Columbus is going to make his way across the Atlantic in search of God, gold, and glory, thus establishing the Columbian Exchange, which was the exchange of goods between the Old World and the New. And yes, that also included diseases that would eventually wipe out generations of natives. Also a key component in this unit, we got our revolutions. No, not that kind, but the agricultural revolutions. The first of which included the process of going from hunters and gatherers to becoming sedentary, the utilization of simple tools, and the domestication of animals for farming purposes. Then there's the second agricultural revolution. This is where we started getting down and dirty, where we humans show our true colors with our industrial revolution and mechanization of farming with tools such as the McCormick Reaper, which sounds a lot like a bad time on a Tuesday night. And we also have tools like the seed drill, which for farmers like myself, saved us from the back-aching process of planting each seed individually. You get the point. So thus, the second agricultural revolution would lead to better diets and more food, which will lead to longer life expectancy, and finally lead to more people in the labor force, particularly in families. Remember, it's important to note that this would ultimately lead to less farmers. As with the new tech, you don't need as many farmers, so people will move into the cities for new jobs. We now move on to the Green Revolution, which included further mechanization of labor and the use of genetically modified organisms, where we would change the genetic makeup of plants in order to extract every ounce of profit. We would even develop high-yield seeds and start utilizing pesticides and herbicides to make sure insects don't destroy our crops. The Green Revolution even included the practice of using more efficient fertilizers and manure.
I always imagine less manure. You need to spread it. I mean, some manure, just less.
This is beet food.
Mose, what are you doing? No, Mose. Put the manure down. Put it down. Do not throw it. Do not. Ow!
Don't throw your poop, children. The Green Revolution also included aquaculture and their essentially controlled environments for farming fish. In case that was a bit much, here's a compiled list for all the examples of the Green Revolution. You can even pause here in case you want to jot them down. Big Brother College Board also wants you to note the pros and cons of the Green Revolution, and the pros included the ability to make cheaper food, increasing yield for farmers, and reducing global hunger. However, on the other hand, we'd run into environmental damage from the pesticides and herbicides, social inequality as the machines increase startup costs, and a lack of biodiversity, which causes certain strains of plants to go extinct. You're also responsible for knowing intensive and extensive agriculture. Intensive agriculture generally needs small plots of land with a higher demand of labor and for the most part a greater initial investment, whereas extensive agriculture you'll see large plots of land, lower labor input, and less of an initial investment. Then you also need to be able to differentiate commercial agriculture, which is the process of farming for profit and can lead to growing cash crops, and monocropping, the process of cultivating only one crop, and subsistence agriculture, which is the process of farming for survival and feeding your own family. Which brings us to the bid rent theory, a theory that takes into consideration the price of the land and the distance relative to the CBD. Let us use this line as an example. If you're closer to the CBD, land costs will increase, and as you move further out, the land costs will decrease. And because land is so expensive near the CBD, you'll have higher densities and lower densities away from the CBD. This means that you're more likely to see extensive agriculture further away and intensive agriculture closer to the CBD. And this transitions us perfectly to the von Thunen model, which was created in 1800, so obviously before the prevalence of cars, and this model theorized the various placement of agricultural practices, starting with the dairying and the market gardening, as these goods are more likely to go bad and needed to be closer to the CBD. After that, there's the forest and timber, which needed to be closer because if you're trying to transport timber on a wagon, you got a first-class ticket to the struggle bus. Then you have your extensive farming with your grains and your rye, which needed a lot of land, and according to the bid-rent theory, which is implemented in the von Thunen model, land is cheaper further away from the CBD, plus these crops tended to be less perishable. And lastly, you have your grazing, which needs the most land as cows generally need to have large plots of land to graze on, and because it was further from the CBD, the land was cheap for farmers to obtain. Let's finally look at the settlement patterns, and in this topic, there are three main methods. We got nucleated, aka clustered, dispersed, and linear. Clustered means the farms are clustered. Dispersed means that the farms are dispersed. And linear means that the farms are in a line.
Nice.
The important part here is to be able to pair these with the types of farming that they might be associated with. For example, a wheat farm is more likely to be dispersed, and a wet rice farm clustered. Here are some GPS examples of what a cluster farm might look like in Uchijuku, Japan, and a dispersed farm in West Union, Iowa. In today's episode of Guess That Geo, I'm going to show you the area first and see if you can guess it. We'll zoom in on some of these signs. Go ahead, pause the video and guess in the comments down below. If you said Quebec, Canada, you can request another Lamborghini of your choice. They're on back order right now with the disruption in the supply chain, so you might have to wait a little bit. But a few things I notice. I see French, especially with the Pierre. Anytime I see this turquoise and Victorian architecture, I think Western Europe, and the cars are driving on the right, and the biggest clue is the flag right here, which is the flag of Quebec, and a sign that literally says Canada just a bit away. The reason why we're looking at Quebec is because they are home to the linear farming method, as you can see here. And this transitions us perfectly to the survey methods, first of which is the long lot method, and this is the most prevalent in Quebec and Louisiana, so generally the French-influenced regions. Then you have the township and range and the meets and bounds. For the meets and bounds, you'll see this more along the East Coast, and the township and range shows the Midwest and West Coast. Think of it this way. When the settlers first came to the United States, initially they weren't worried about organization. They were just thinking about survival. Then later on, as the government was well established and they started moving west, they were able to come up with an organized system of surveying land. Our founding father, George Washington, was actually a land surveyor himself, and he used the meets and bounds. Imagine George Washington trying to figure out how big his backyard's gonna be. He's probably thinking something like, I think I'll go to that tree over yonder. Obviously, that's not how it went, but using landmarks was just about the most efficient method they had at this time. The township and range, however, was much more organized. With the Northwest Land Ordinance, they came up with a systematic method of admitting new pieces of land, and the easiest way to do so was to make them into a bunch of squares, as you can see in the Midwest right here. Alright, that about does it for part one of the agriculture unit. Once again, I posted the Quizlet in the description in case you want to review the vocabulary terms. I appreciate you all tuning in, and we will see you in the next one.